Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Harp of Kings by Juliet Marillier. Narrated by Frazer Douglas, Moira Quirk, and Alex Wyndham.
Chapter 1. Liobhan. A pox on Arku! Why must we fight in a wretched downpour? I hook my left leg around Brock's right and throw my full weight backward, toppling us both to the ground. We roll, coating ourselves with mud. Shit! Who would want to do this for the rest of their life? I must be crazy! The wind gusts in, straight off the northern sea, driving the rain sideways. Brock curses. There's a little catch in his breath. I've almost got him. Go for his nuts! Someone shouts. Grab her hair! Yells someone else. Dow, I'm guessing. He likes to see me lose. There's no need to look at Ahu, even if I could turn my head. I know what he's thinking. This isn't some brawl behind the drinking hall. It's training for the real thing. You've got advantages. Use them. Superior height, I tell myself as Brock fights his way up onto one knee and, for a moment, loosens his hold on my right arm. Stronger will to win. Sheer bloody-mindedness. I claw up a handful of mud and throw it in his face. He swears, releases his hold, puts his hands up to his eyes. I twist onto my knees and deliver a well-calculated punch to his jaw, and he's down.
Cease.
Ahu lifts his hand.
Bout goes to Liobhan.
It's over, thank the gods of wind and weather. There's a scattering of applause from our drenched comrades, who are required to observe all bouts, no matter what the weather. Ahu believes there's always something to learn, especially from watching people make mistakes. I hold out a hand to Brock and haul him to his feet.
Should have seen that coming,
he mumbles, swiping at his face with his mud-soaked sleeve. What can I say? We've been sparring together since we were children. He knows I'll use dirty tricks to win if that's what it takes. More often than not, I do win against Brock. He's too honourable for his own good.
Untidy bout, says Ahu. Brock, you had the advantage there briefly, but you let it go. Don't let your thoughts drift off, especially in these conditions. Sharpen your eyes, sharpen your ears. Feel what's going on in every part of your body. Even as you counter her move, you should be anticipating her next. If she catches you unprepared, you're gone. Make an error like that in a real situation and you might be dead, which would be less than useful to whoever's paying for your services. Here.
He fishes a disreputable cloth from some hidden corner of his voluminous fur cloak. The garment is almost legendary, and passes it over.
Wipe that stuff off your face.
He turns toward me.
Liobhan, quick thinking there. I hope you haven't done your brother any damage. There are cleaner ways you could have ended that. Tell me some.
I've been running over the fight in my mind since Ahu always asks this. If I'd been quicker after we both went down, I could have thrown my full weight across him. Or earlier on, when I did the lock and throw move, if I'd placed my feet wider, I could have blocked him from doing that spring back up.
The spring was well executed.
Arku's hard gaze goes to Brock, and he gives a brief nod of approval.
You're nimble, no doubt of that.
He's cut out to be a strolling player.
Dow again, supercilious bastard.
A man of many talents, singing, harping, tumbling, and tricks.
I clench my teeth over the withering retort this comment deserves. Self-restraint is part of the Swan Island code, and Ahu is present. Ahu, who will in time help decide which of us trainees become permanent members of the warrior band and which are dispatched home with the weight of failure on their shoulders. As for Brock, he says not a word.
You'd be surprised, Ahu observes, what talents a Swan Island warrior can use to strategic advantage. Some of them you might not think of as combat skills. Should any of you be fortunate enough to stay the course and find a long-term place on the island, you'll find that the services we offer are diverse. It's not all heading out festooned with shiny weapons and killing the other fellow before he kills you. Though you need to learn that as well. Anyone else have any observations? They do, of course. Our group has been on the island for 2 turnings of the moon, and the training's been intense. We work every day and often nights as well. We need to be capable under all conditions. Ahu is chief combat trainer on Swan Island, but others also teach us. There are experts in swordsmanship, archery, fighting with staves and with bare hands, as you'd expect at a school of warcraft. We learn the best way to scale rock faces and what to do if someone gets stuck or falls, and how to fight off attackers when you're halfway up a cliff and hanging on for dear life. We're taught the care and maintenance of our equipment, from weapons to boots. Checks occur at irregular intervals, and if one of us is found with an ill-cleaned knife or muddy footwear, we all pay the price. A mouse-like woman named Ava teaches us how to open locked doors and to hide effectively right under folks' noses. That is harder for a tall, sturdily built person than a slight one, as I have cause to know. The colour of my hair, a vivid red, doesn't help. One skill we can't learn on the island is mounted combat. Horses can't be kept here. There's not much level ground, and all of it's taken up by the training facilities and living quarters. The remainder of the island, steep rises, sudden dips, sheer cliffs, is given over to sheep, seals, and puffins. Swan Island has a fleet of small boats, some for fishing, some to transfer people and supplies between island and mainland, and some, as we've discovered, kept so we can practice fighting on a shifting deck without falling overboard. Our trainer for that is Haki, a giant Norseman. We never forget that we're on trial here. Exercises to test us can happen at any time of the day or night, and all the time our tutors are watching us. Who is the best, the strongest, the most promising? No point in asking who wants it most. All of us do, or we wouldn't be putting ourselves through this. Brock and I prepared for months to win places in the training course, from which maybe 2 or 3 out of the 20 will be chosen to stay as permanent members of the Swan Island Force. Nobody wants to be sent home. If I was doing the choosing, I'd pick Dow. He may be the least likable of the trainees, but he excels in all the physical tasks, and he's clever at solving puzzles and devising strategies. Brock isn't the strongest fighter in the group, but he has other skills that might prove to be assets to Swan Island. It seems to me our trainers recognise his unusual talents, though none of them says anything. My brother has a remarkable ability for keeping other people calm under testing conditions, and he has a way of using his senses that goes beyond the ordinary, not just when he's playing music, but all the time. As for me, I know I'm good enough. But although there are quite a few women working and living in the Swan Island community, and several female tutors, the elite fighting group has only 2 female members. That's 2 out of a force of more than 50. And in this group of trainees, I'm the only woman. The odds are not in my favour. But I will prove myself. I didn't come here to fail.
If you want my opinion, Dow says now, Brock goes easy on Liobhan because she's a female. He's hardly going to pinch her breast or dig an elbow in her privates, and he'd never stand by while someone else attacked his sister. The expression on his face right now proves it.
I manage not to look at Brock, though I know how he must be feeling. Wretched Dow. Along with his other talents comes an unerring ability to find and exploit a person's weak spot. I can see how that might come in useful, but I'd prefer him not to exercise it on the rest of us. No comment from Ahu. He's biding his time, letting us hang ourselves with our own rope.
That's bollocks, Dow.
This is our Norse trainee, Hrothgar, a big, bearded man. I get on well with Hrothgar.
He's told me how it was where he grew up, how the women can be leaders and fighters and heads of the household if there is a need, and how they are respected for whatever they do. His sister wanted to come with him to Swan Island, but she's only 13, 5 years younger than me.
Brock's a fine fighter, Hrothgar goes on. How do you think Liobhan got so good? By practicing with him for years, that's how. He's got his own style, that's all. As for standing by while someone attacked one of your comrades, male or female, would you do that?
There might be a time when I had to, Dow says. What if we were on a mission, undercover, and defending my comrade would mean destroying that cover? Haven't we been told that fulfilling the mission must always come first?
He glances at Ahu, but if our trainer replies, his words are drowned by a sudden, violent increase in the rain. It roars across the island, blotting out everything in sight and making an abrupt end to conversation. Ahu points in the general direction of the nearest building, and we sprint for shelter. The rain is still bucketing down outside, hours later as we sit in the hall after supper. This is the time when the whole community comes together to enjoy food and drink and good fellowship. Tales are told before the hearth fire, jugs of mead or ale are passed around, and those of us who can play or sing provide musical entertainment. Brock and I both love music. At home, our band was in demand for village weddings and festivals. We even played for some grand gatherings in the household of Dalriada's Crown Prince, which is not far from our family home. The Swan Island community soon learned we were musicians. The arrival of Brock with his harp strapped to his back made it pretty plain. Ahu is a musician too. The man's arms are all muscle. He handles the boorish as he handles the sword, as if it's an extension of himself. You can hear the warrior's marching feet and beating heart in his playing, and the sound of the island's natural world. The great wings of the albatross, the dive and twist of a seal, the thrum of wind in thatch. He's as much a master of drumming as he is of just about every form of combat. Ahu doesn't talk about his life before the island, or where and how he developed those skills. And we don't ask. But I'd like to hear his story one day. On the evening after that bout in the mud, Haki tells a story of his time as an Ulfhednar, a wolfskin. The role of these peerless warriors is to leap from the prow of the longship as it comes into shore, setting terror into the hearts of their enemies. They're godsworn, and from the sound of it, more than half crazy. This particular tale concerns an axe that was blessed by the gods, which for a long time brought good fortune to the man who wielded it. But when it fell into the hands of another, everything changed. We're all captivated by this story, and I can see from my brother's intense concentration that he's already making it into a song.
And on the night Brynjolf breathed his last breath, Haki's voice has dropped to a near whisper. The man who sat vigil over him swore that although the axe rested beside him on his bier, they could hear its voice in the air above him, singing the true song of a fine blade. Home, my faithful one, come home now to the hall of the gods. And to the one who stole me from you, I say. A curse upon you for your betrayal of a friend. May your sword be blunt and your arm be weak, and may your enemies laugh in your face until the day you die. It's a fine story. Who cares if it's true or not? Next, it's our turn to entertain. A makeshift band made up of me, Brock, Ahu, and Ema, a girl who's good on the whistle. I'm capable on the whistle too. In a band, the more things you can turn your hand to, the better. Ema and I are performing a reel as question and answer, taking 8 measures in turn and gradually speeding up. By the end, the would-be dancers are falling over their own feet and breathless with laughter. It all feels oddly right. Swan Island's warriors are the best of the best in combat, and their deeds are spoken of in hushed tones all over Erin, forming the stuff of fireside tales. Yet at times like this, they're a big, warm family.
The song requests flood in. Fortunately, we know most of them. An evening's entertainment might start with story songs, grand ones that tell of epic voyages, of monsters slain and captives freed. We'd follow on with more modest ones, such as how a hapless third son won the hand of a princess, who then proved to be more trouble than he'd bargained for. There are ribald songs suited to the drinking hall, and tragic ballads of lost love, and marching songs that get the older men singing along with the chorus, whether they remember the words or not. Brock and I both like making up verses and tunes. Our voices blend well. Mine strong and deep for a woman, his light and pure with a quality in it that goes straight to the heart. At home, we're often asked for our love songs, which are perfect for hand fastings. They're a less obvious choice for Swan Island, but tonight I can see Dow sitting at the back, yawning in undisguised boredom, and rather than choose something I think might be to his taste, though who knows what that might be, I decide to give him the sweetest, most romantic song in our repertoire. "The Farewell," I murmur to my fellow musicians. Brock lifts his eyebrows a touch, but neither he nor Ahu makes any comment. "The Farewell" is a ballad that makes grown men and women cry. Our arrangement begins with harp alone, Brock plucking out the melody that starts low and soars high before settling not on the final of the mode, but on the sixth, leaving the sense of an unfinished journey or an unanswered question. "Will you come with me wherever I go? Will you stay by me in joy and in woe? When the sun warms the hills, when the storm stirs the sea, in shadow and light, will you walk on with me? Oh, I will come with you wherever you go, and I will stay by you in joy and in woe. I'll walk close beside you through tempest and calm, and I'll keep you safe with the strength of my arm." The song follows the lovers on their pathway together. There's the joyous wedding day, the moment the man first holds his newborn son in his arms, the building of a little house overlooking the sea. A walk side by side, as they've promised. But a time comes when the husband suffers an injury and the wound festers and he falls deathly sick. This leads him onto a road where she cannot follow. Not yet. There is a child to raise, and for all her sorrow, she must live on to bring up their son in strength, courage, and wisdom. The husband speaks, "I cannot come with you wherever you go, and I cannot stay by you in joy and in woe. But I'll be beside you, though gone from your sight. I'll love you and guard you till we meet in the light." Brock sings this last verse unaccompanied, his voice growing ever quieter. The final notes sound into a deep hush. The audience holds its silence a long while before anyone stirs. Then thunderous applause fills the hall, and I spot a number of folk wiping their eyes, some furtively, some openly, for what is the purpose of a good song if not to stir the feelings, whatever they may be? Fists pound on tables. "More!" people shout. But Brock is exhausted. I can read him well, and the day has tried him hard in both body and spirit. "One more request," I call over the buzz of talk, "and nothing sad." "Artigan's leap," someone shouts. "Let's see your best dancing, then." Whistles to lips, Ema and I launch into the jig, with Ahu sounding out the beat. 4 measures later, Brock's harp begins to weave its magic around the tune. A few energetic folk take up the dance, but the hour is late, and most are content to stamp their feet, thump their fists on the tables, or clap their hands. We draw to a triumphant close. I wish everyone good night, smiling, and give a sketchy half bow to make it clear the evening's entertainment is over. Folk retrieve the cloaks and shawls they've draped near the fire to dry and head out of the hall. It sounds as if the rain has slackened, perhaps even stopped. With luck, I can make it to the women's quarters without getting another set of clothing soaked. And there is Dow, leaning against the doorpost, effectively blocking my way.
Good performance tonight.
Thanks, I say, taken aback. Didn't think you had any interest in music. Other folk are pushing past us now, wanting to take advantage of the break in the weather.
I've heard my share of minstrels, from the excellent to the execrable.
Dow's tone is neutral, which is as close as he ever gets to sounding friendly.
You sing well. Makes me wonder why you'd want to fight for a living when you could be doing something more...
He lets this fade away. Since long before my brother and I came to Swan Island, I've been working on my temper, knowing that if anything is likely to cause me problems here, it's my tendency to speak without thinking, especially when I'm angry. I count silently to 5 before I speak again. Appropriate for a woman? I lift my brows. Seemly?
Seemly is not a term I'd ever use for you, Liobhan, even when you're dressed like that.
A dip of his head indicates my performing attire. Under the cloak, I have on a gown in russet wool and a cream linen overdress in place of my usual trousers and tunic. My feet are in soft slippers instead of boots, and my hair has been liberated from the tight, pinned-up plait I wear for combat.
I do wonder why a woman would spend her days learning more effective ways to kill, Dow says, and her evenings singing love songs. Wouldn't that mean she could not put her whole heart into either activity?
In the hall behind me, people are clearing tables, banking up the fire, saying their goodnights. I peer past Dow into the darkness outside, where a few torches illuminate the pathway linking hall with living quarters. I can't let his bizarre question go unanswered. But it's late. The rain will be back at any moment, and keeping a crowd entertained is tiring work, nearly as exhausting as an afternoon of bouts in the practice yard. Are you suggesting that a person with 2 talents cannot successfully exercise both, I ask?
If they're at odds, it would surely be wiser to direct your efforts into one or the other.
Dao has relaxed into his leaning pose. He seems in no hurry to move on.
Say you were a leader of men, a king or chieftain, and the other thing you were good at was
calming fretful babies. When he scowls at me, I add, fine embroidery, wood carving.
Mine was a serious argument.
So was mine.
Bollocks, Liobhan. Kings don't do needlework or look after infants.
I smile despite myself. They might want to, I say. That's no odder than a female becoming a good fighter, and the skills learned in those occupations, babies, embroidery and the like, might come in very handy when dealing with argumentative counsellors, one delicate step at a time. Patience, for instance, and precision.
Show me a king doing fine embroidery and I'll concede the argument.
Not sure I'll ever get the opportunity, kings being somewhat thin on the ground in these parts. I won't be sharing the information that my brother and I are on good terms with the Crown Prince of Dalriada, or that our parents are personal friends of his father. Don't you have some other talent, Dow? An able fellow like you?
That's none of your business.
His expression has changed in an instant. I think of a creature snarling as it faces the point of a spear. How did I manage to provoke that? Weren't you the one who introduced this topic of conversation? I try to keep my tone light.
A pointless exercise, as it turns out. I'll wish you good night.
No need to exert yourself. I pull my cloak around my shoulders and head out.
Hey, Liobhan.
His voice comes after me.
What?
I do not turn.
Beat me in unarmed combat, 2 out of 3, and I'll concede the argument.
I've already forgotten what it was about, I lie.
Afraid to fight me?
Not in the least, as you well know, but I'm wary of wagers, especially if we might be breaking some island rule.
We'll make it official. Get Ahu's permission.
I'll say yes, of course. I never could resist a challenge. Dow must know that. He's observant.
And this is to prove what, exactly? I've turned to face him despite myself. Dao hesitates. The torch set above the doorway has transformed his features into a flickering, shadow-eyed mask. Under the ready wit and derisive manner, there's something else, I think. Something he hides with expertise.
That to be the best, you must give body, heart, and spirit, he says. You have to put all of yourself into whatever you choose to do. That means one vocation and one only. If you're the best, there's nothing left to give.
For a few moments, I stand there staring at him, quite silent.
I accept the challenge, I say eventually, as the rain begins to fall again, steady and quiet. But not to contest that theory, only because I know I can beat you, and only if Ahu gives his blessing, and only if this isn't some trick you've set up.
His mouth twists.
No trick, unless it's on myself. Good night now.
Night, I mumble, and run for the women's quarters. What ails the man? He's a chieftain's son with all the advantages that provides, and he's a presentable specimen of manhood as well, tall and well-muscled, with wheat-gold hair and features many would consider handsome, though the effect is often marred by the expression he chooses to show the world. If I were inclined to take any of my fellow trainees to bed, which I'm not, since that could see me sent off the island in haste, there'd be quite a few I'd choose before Dao. For me, a good character far outweighs beauty, though I must admit that it helps if they have both. As I hang up my damp cloak and search for my nightrobe, it occurs to me that not once in that odd conversation was my brother mentioned. And if Dao thinks I can't make the grade as a warrior if I want to be a musician as well, surely the same must go for Brock. Even more so for Brock, since if anyone puts heart and soul into his music, it's him. I enjoy playing and singing, and I try to do it well. But Brock gets lost in it. When we finish a performance, it takes him a while to come back. That's the reason I do the talking in between ballad and air and reel. I suspect the true reason for Dao's wager is nothing to do with music. I've beaten him in a fight with staves, and I've scored better in archery several times. He simply can't accept that a woman might surpass him in such manly pursuits. That will make winning his challenge particularly satisfying.
Chapter 2. Dao. Day 63 on Swan Island. I add the results of yesterday's bouts to my tally. I do not keep this record in writing, since our shared quarters are not supplied with the required materials. Fortunately, I have an excellent memory. Today's cumulative totals see me still at the top of the order, though four others now press uncomfortably close. One of these is Liobhan. I had expected her early promise to be short-lived, a product of her energy and unbounded self-belief. But I am obliged to concede that she is strong for a female and has been well-trained, though clearly not by experts. Her brother, too. I would rank him in the top few, though less likely to win a place than she is. The difference between them is striking. Liobhan is tall and of athletic build, though undeniably female in form. Her brother is shorter and sparer. Where his sister is powerful, he is quick and flexible. He lacks Livorn's imposing, high-boned features, but there is an intensity in his gaze that holds the eye, especially when he sings. If a battle could be won with music, Brock would be the one to do it. Livorn's hair is flaming red, Brock's dark. Her eyes are green, his brown. Perhaps one takes after each parent, who knows? It is possible that neither will stay the course. The island elders might think twice about accepting a brother and sister pair, for reasons that should be obvious. On a mission, surely the instinct to protect one's sibling would get in the way of balanced judgment. And would it not hamper operations if care had to be taken not to send the two away together? If I were in Ahu's position, Which of our group would I choose? Myself, obviously. And I would give serious consideration to Hrothgar. He is a solid all-rounder, with admirable self-control. The Norseman would never use dirty tricks as Livorn does. Of all the trainees, he is the one I would choose to stand beside me in battle. My current tally shows Livorn second, Hrothgar a close third, Brock a surprising fourth, with Kianan and the Amorican Jan tied for fifth. Of course, combat skills are only one measure of our quality. Who knows what other reasoning our trainers will follow in selecting the few they want to keep? I have looked at their permanent team, those members who are not off the island on one or another mission at present. I have made note of the qualities they display, the types of physique most common among them, their general manner, their daily habits. This may give me an edge over my fellow trainees. As for Livorn, I do not regret issuing a personal challenge. How can I not prevail in a best-out-of-three contest? Thus far, our trainers have not pitted us against each other in unarmed combat, though each of us has fought most of the rest. Livorn has won 15 bouts and lost 2. The fighters whom she defeats are those individuals who see her as woman first, warrior second. They make allowances, offer concessions. Livorn takes full advantage. I cannot criticize her for that. If I were in her situation, I would do the same. The mud was a dirty trick, yes. But to seize the moment when your opponent is off guard, off balance, is to employ good strategic thinking. Every such instance will be noted by our trainers. I do regret lowering my guard when I spoke to her in the doorway. To be the best, you must give body, heart, and spirit. What possessed me to say that to her, of all people? I had thought to unsettle her. I had thought to test her true commitment. But the conversation drifted. I lost control of my words. To do so is a sure sign of weakness, and I must not be weak. I must win at all costs. I must stay on the island. One way or another, going home would be the end of me.
Chapter 3. Brock. Though not so very distant in miles, this place seems as far from home as a land of ancient story. There's a quality about the island that unsettles me, a strangeness words are not adequate to describe. I wandered into a cave near the western point, place of great stillness, with a subterranean pool that catches the light from an opening far above. When I looked in the water, I saw a reflection that was not my own. At least Livorn is making the most of her opportunity on Swan Island. That justifies my decision to come here with her. Nobody knows how dearly that choice cost me, and I will make sure nobody ever does. My parents gave me the best family in all Erin, and the most loving home any son could wish for. To leave that home behind set sadness in my heart and laid cold fingers of fear on my spirit. I'm not afraid to fight, but I'm afraid to walk out into the unknown and perhaps find answers to questions I don't want to ask. I'm doing my best to win a place on the island despite that. Our training has served Livorn and me well. We can hold our own against the sons of chieftains, men who have been expertly trained by their father's masters at arms. Livorn has more natural ability than I, as well as a stronger determination to succeed. She drives herself forward with an intensity that is almost frightening. I see the others watching her, and I think they're torn between envy and outrage that a woman can fight so well, that she does so with such clear purpose, harnessing her strength to the task confounds them. Some try to goad her with derisive comments. They suggest she might warm one man's bed or another's. She gives them short shrift. Thank the gods for music. The harp is my map and lodestone, my balm and comfort. It quiets my circling thoughts as nothing else can. I sing and play every night, even when I'm fighting. My mind teems with tunes and verses. I'm glad to have the opportunity here to gladden folks' hearts with our music. I had thought in those first days that Livorn's passion to prove herself on the field of combat might see her setting aside other pastimes as a waste of her time and strength. But no, still she sings, and folk hush to listen. I wish I could write a letter to my mother and father. I would relate the tale of our experiences on the island. I would send my love to Galen and my regards to Prince Ailu. And I would finish by saying that although I miss them all, the opportunities offered here are so great that I would not think of leaving. Who would not want to excel? Who would not want a chance to change the course of battles or to influence the minds of the powerful? But I will not tell lies, not even in my thoughts.
Chapter 4. Liobhan.
What? I see the look on Arhu's face and take a breath. I'm sorry. Could you say that again, please?
You've been selected for a mission, the two of you.
It's Canella speaking, the island leader, a grey-bearded veteran. When the messenger brought Brock and me to the small council chamber and we found both Canella and Arhu waiting for us, I was sure they were going to send us home. This is unbelievable.
You don't have long to prepare, Canella goes on. A few days, that's all. There's a long ride, and time will be short once you reach your destination. Since you're still in training, I'm giving you the chance to say no to this without penalty.
It's unusual to be sent before you win a place among us, as doubtless you know.
This is no training exercise. The mission's real, and so is the danger, and your preparation is far from complete. But we need you.
Morrigan's britches, it's true. This really is happening to me. I can hardly believe it. Trainees simply don't get sent on missions. This has to mean we're doing well, exceptionally well. I open my mouth to say, yes, yes!
With respect, Master Canella, says Brock, his voice not quite steady. It would be unwise to make a decision when we know almost nothing about the mission. What can you tell us?
Sit down, Canella says.
We sit, and he spreads out a sheet of parchment on the table. It's a map, with a route marked out in red ink beside the black lines and symbols of coastline, forest, rivers, settlements, tracks, and byways. Canella traces a line with his finger.
Here is Swan Island. Our team will travel on horseback to a destination some day's ride to the south, here.
The Kingdom of Brefner. His fingers cover the name, but I know what I'm looking at.
The team will be undercover. I won't give you the full details unless you agree to be part of it. When we undertake this sort of job, we don't spread the information any more widely than we need, even here, where all are tried and trusted.
Except the trainees. That is the part he doesn't say. But it makes sense. Most of us won't end up staying on the island, and when those who fail are sent back home, there's no certainty all will keep to the promise we made when we were accepted for training, which was that we won't talk about anything we've seen or heard, no matter what. I understand there are questions you can't answer at this point, I say. Can you tell us what we'd be doing, in general terms, I mean, and how many would be on the team? I manage to sound steadier than Brock, which is a miracle considering how hard my heart is thumping.
Three,
says Canella.
Who's the third? Asks Brock.
I am.
Ahu sounds mildly amused.
We'll also send a backup team to be close by in case of unforeseen problems. They'll do their own looking and listening, but their main purpose is to help us if we get in trouble. They'll travel separately and contact with them will be minimal. As for the activity, something's gone missing, something irreplaceable, and a certain influential person needs it found and returned before Midsummer Day. That must be done without anyone else finding out it's gone. It won't be easy. We'll need to maintain our cover until the job is completed and we're safely back here. And we won't be able to question folk directly about the missing item, since that might arouse suspicion. This will require discretion, subtlety, observation, and the ability to play a part.
We're not sure who's behind this, says Canella, but if you're found out, Not only will the mission fail, but you may be in personal danger. The guys you travel in won't allow you to carry weapons openly. A small knife at the belt, perhaps. No more. If you agree to this, Ahu will give you the rules of engagement.
So this is spying more than fighting?
Correct. What do you say?
I look at Brock. He looks at me. Yes, we say together. I try to stop a big grin from spreading across my face. Why they would choose us over seasoned warriors, I can't imagine. Best not ask. Canella might think I was challenging his decision.
Very well, he says. That is something of a relief, since we have no other musicians of your expertise currently available, and for purposes of this mission, that is what the three of you will be. Travelling minstrels, entertainers. We need to get you right into the court of Brefna without arousing suspicion.
It's like a punch in the belly. Travelling minstrels. We've been chosen not because of our skills in combat or our courage and resourcefulness, but because we can sing and play. I'm lost for words. What is it we'll be looking for? Asks Brock, sounding not in the least put out.
A harp. A very particular harp. It's old. It's one of a kind. And the only time it's played is at Brefna's coronation ritual. The instrument is known as the Harp of Kings. To the people of Brefna, it's of deep significance. If it isn't played at the ritual, the man who's up for the kingship won't be accepted by the populace. Even if, as in this case, he has a very strong claim.
Despite my disappointment, I'm intrigued. Who looks after this harp in between its rather rare outings?
The local druids. They keep it locked away. Now it's disappeared. Stolen, hidden, perhaps lied about, who knows? Part of the job will be finding out who might be wanting to disrupt the ritual and why.
A harp needs playing, says Brock. Not once every few years for a special occasion, but every day. An old harp would need a lot of maintenance, and even so, they don't last forever. Just how ancient is this instrument?
I can't answer that, Canella says, and you won't be able to ask it at the court of Brefna, not straight out. But if someone else should mention the Harp of Kings, as well they might with the ritual coming up and you being a harpist yourself, you could quite naturally chat about it.
What can you tell us about the man who's to become king on Midsummer Day, I ask?
The old king, Angus, died several years ago. This young man is his son. Brefna won't crown a king before his 18th birthday, and it's always done at Midsummer. This time around, Rodan is old enough.
Who's been doing the job since the last king died?
A regent, Kara, a kinsman of the former king. It was Lord Kara who asked us for help. Unfortunately, his message took some while to reach us, which is why we're short of time to achieve the mission. He's the one you'll be talking to at the other end, though it'll mainly be Ahu doing that. Those who know about the harp going missing can be counted on the fingers of one hand. The chief druid and one or two of his most trusted brethren. Kara's senior counsellor. The heir, Rodan, hasn't been told. Kara fears that if the truth gets out, Rodan's claim will be considered tainted, even if you do find the harp in time. The claimant must be accepted by all, or there will be challenges. We need to get the harp back to the druids and keep the secret close.
The sinking feeling in my stomach has eased. They're placing a remarkable amount of trust in us, untested as we are. Achieve this, and our chances of staying on at Swan Island will be much stronger even if neither of us so much as lays a hand on a weapon.
No trace of your real identity goes with you when you leave this place on a mission, Kinella tells us. Each of you gets a new name, a new family, a new history. Those details are up to Breed. She's our senior trainer for this kind of thing, and she'll be preparing you. You'll need to learn fast. The hardest part, when you're new to this, is knowing how to keep your mouth shut under pressure. Not to reveal where you really came from and why. Not to betray your comrades. You don't pick up that skill in a quick training session.
Is he suggesting that if our purpose becomes known, we may be subject to torture? I remembered Dow's words after that fight in the mud, saying he'd stand aside while his comrade was attacked if that was the only way to protect the mission. Ahu's gaze is on me, as if he knows what I'm thinking.
We wouldn't be giving you this opportunity if we didn't believe you could do it, he says. It's real, it's important, and we wouldn't risk you if you weren't capable. You'll have training with the others as usual this morning. Later in the day, we'll be moving you over to the mainland settlement for some specialized preparation, including getting those cover stories perfect. It goes without saying that you don't let your fellow trainees know about this. Act as if it's an ordinary day until I come and find you after the midday meal.
Understood, I say. What will the others think when we suddenly disappear? What story will be told to cover our absence? Thank you for the opportunity. We'll do our best.
Thank us when it's over, says Canella.
It's no surprise when we're told to keep our packing light. We'll be leaving quickly and quietly while the rest of the trainees are elsewhere on the island honing their rope climbing skills. I fill a small pack with the allowable items. A sheathed knife is the only weapon approved, and I have to leave all my protective gear behind, since I'll be a musician, not a fighter. I pack my three whistles, a pair of trousers, which I'm permitted to wear under a skirt for riding, a few personal items, a spare shirt and stockings, the good gown and overdress I wear for our evening performances. It isn't much. My brother is waiting for me outside the quarters, with his bag already packed and his harp, in its protective leather case, strapped to his back. Apart from him, the place seems deserted. We may as well go down to the jetty, I say. It feels odd not to be saying goodbye to anyone, but we'll be back soon enough, I suppose. Brock gives a crooked smile.
It'll be odder still to return here if the rest of them have been told we've gone home. That's the most likely explanation when we suddenly vanish.
Dow should be happy, since he sees you as his arch rival, and he'll be furious when you come back. He'll be chosen to stay on. The island leaders will assume Dow has the stuff of future leadership in him, since he's a chieftain's son. The odds are in his favour. Though it pains me to admit it, I add, he's good at everything.
Oh, he's got excellent combat skills, I don't deny that. But there's more to this than being able to fight well. You've seen how the island folk are with one another. You know the codes of behaviour they follow. Dow needs to learn tolerance, comradeship, open-mindedness, flexibility and, well, you get my drift. For some folk, that sort of thing is much harder to learn than hitting the target 9 times out of 10 or outmaneuvering your opponent with the staff.
The jetty's in sight now, and there are more people waiting on it than I was expecting. I squint against the sunlight, trying to identify them.
Ahu, says Brock helpfully, as we walk down the precipitous path.
He's blessed with uncannily sharp vision.
Breed, 2 ferrymen, and that's Ullen, you know, the tall, skinny fellow who often works on the mainland, and... You won't like this.
I've seen who the last figure is. Nobody else on Swan Island has that golden hair, nor that air of languid superiority, plain even at a distance in the way he stands.
Morrigan's breeches, what is he doing there?
He has a bag like ours. He has a cloak slung over his shoulder. He can't be coming with us, can he? Didn't Arku say something about a backup team? Asks Brock. Why would they choose Dao of all people? This feels decidedly strange. It's as if we've somehow conjured him up by discussing his prospects. He's not a musician, and he's not a seasoned fighter. Maybe, my brother says, what they told us was only half the truth. Maybe this is not so much a mission as a test. Of what? Whatever each of us most needs to learn. While crossing to the mainland, we learn that Alan and Dao are the backup team. Like ours, their roles have been chosen to suit a royal household dealing with an influx of visitors. Alan was a farrier by trade before he came to Swan Island, and they'll be needing extra workers in Brefner's royal stables. Dao is to act as his assistant. That may not be too much of a stretch for a man of his background. Hunting and hawking are part and parcel of a nobleman's life. He must know horses, though he may be accustomed to handing his mount over to some underling the moment the hunt returns home. Dao is strong and physically able. Under Alan's supervision, that may be enough. We know the mainland settlement houses stables and a training area for mounted combat. We know the people who live over there provide supporting services to the Swan Island community. Until now, we didn't know about the barn. This establishment was no doubt once home to cattle, hay, and farm implements. Now it's a well-guarded maze of chambers and workshops in which certain skills are taught and practiced away from the public eye. At one end, there are sleeping quarters, men's and women's areas separated by a rather inadequate screen. "Not that you'll be getting much rest," is Breed's comment as she shows us the hard, narrow pallets. "You've got a lot to learn and not much time to do it. Stow your gear and report to me in the long room through that way." From the first, she makes us use only our mission names. Brock is Donal, I'm Kira, Ahu is Art, and he is my uncle. We're enough alike, tall, broad-shouldered, fair of complexion, to make that believable. Uncle Art is unmarried. He treats me as his daughter. Breed has decided that Donal and Kira will not be the brother and sister Brock and I are in real life, since we look nothing alike. The story is that Donal joined up with Uncle Art and me in hopes of seeing more of the world. Our home village is far to the southeast, far enough to make it unlikely anyone from the region will be present at the court of Brefner. Breed makes us learn all we can about the area anyway, just in case. The village name is an invented one, the location out of the way, and my tale is that I've been travelling with my uncle since my parents died of a plague when I was 14 years old. "So, Kira," says Breed to me on the first morning as we go through this story, "let's say some fellow takes you aside after the evening performance and puts his hand down your bodice or gropes your rear. What do you do?" I know what I would do in real life. It would be swift, decisive, and painful for the man in question. But Kira would not be as strong as Liobhan, or as quick, and she surely wouldn't be as bloody-minded. "Slap him in the face," I say, "and scream for Uncle Art." "And if Uncle Art is not within earshot?" "A knee to the privates, hard enough to hurt, but not to do lasting damage. And I'd say, just wait until Uncle Art hears about this." I ponder this for a moment. But I wouldn't let it happen in the first place. No ducking off into dark corners with strange men. Your first response to some man's crude approach might come before you remember the part you're playing, Breed says. You might act quick as lightning and cripple the fellow, thereby providing a startling demonstration of your fighting skills, which is just what we don't want. It's one thing to tell me what you would do and another to put that into practice. On the other hand, anyone can see you're a big, strong girl, and with luck, that'll make them cautious. She turns her gaze toward Brock. Breed is a woman of about 40, lean and well-muscled. When she looks at a person, it's as if her gaze goes right inside.
How she does that, I have no idea. If I'm chosen to stay on Swan Island, I hope she'll teach me the trick of it.
So, Donal, she says crisply, if some stranger makes advances to your fellow minstrel here, what is your response?
I give Kira a chance to deal with it herself, but I keep an eye on what's happening, and if the man in question looks in my direction, he'll see I'm angry. When and if Kira asks for my help, I give it. I don't get into a fight. I have a stern word with the man concerned, perhaps threaten him with Uncle Art.
What? You wouldn't take matters into your own hands?
Brock returns Breed's stare, cool and calm. Not unless I really think Kira's at risk. I know she's well able to defend herself. If that paints me as a coward in the eyes of the assailant, so be it. Ideally, neither of us would get into a fight, and nor should Uncle Art. You don't go punching someone during the day, then using your hands to play music in the evening. Though, since we've been on the island, that is pretty much what Liobhan and I have been doing. There's a telling silence.
I mean, Kira, of course, Brock says.
Don't slip up again, Donal. The smallest error can see you all in deep trouble and your mission in jeopardy. That would reflect very badly on Swan Island and its leaders. We're taking a calculated risk in entrusting this to you, untrained and inexperienced as you are.
I see the expression on Brock's face. He's disappointed in himself, and feel obliged to speak.
We're beginners in spycraft, yes, but as musicians we are neither untrained nor inexperienced, and we're not bad fighters, the two of us, should those skills be required at any point in the venture.
I hate to see my brother judged for such a small mistake.
What about Dow? He's no more trained and experienced in secret missions than we are, and he's not even a musician.
Breed regards me intently. Brock looks down at his hands. I realise I've just made an error far worse than his.
I'm sorry, I mumble.
That was inappropriate. But timely in its way, Breed says, an illustration of how easy it is to lose your self-control. Explain to me why that was an error. I'm a newcomer to the island, exceptionally fortunate to be given this opportunity. I do my best to sound contrite, though mainly I feel angry. Not with Breed. There's nothing wrong with her self-control. Angry with myself for not knowing when to keep my big mouth shut. It's not for me to question the decisions of my elders and betters.
Breed surprises me by bursting out laughing. Come on, Kira, you can do better than that. Don't insult my intelligence with anything less than an honest answer, please.
The first part was true, about being new and appreciating the opportunity. I understand that on a job like this, the mission leaders and those like you who prepare us have the experience to make sound choices. Those choices include who selected to go and what they do. I shouldn't have said anything about Dow, or challenged anything about how the mission will be carried out.
That's better. At least you made your point now, in the security of the barn. Don't even think of saying such a thing after you leave.
The same goes for you, Donal.
We make our choices carefully. We weigh up the risks and the advantages. Each of you has a weak spot. Even the most seasoned of us does. You must set aside the fact that you'll eventually be in competition for places in our community and do what you've been trusted to do. Execute this mission with the skill, discretion, and good judgment we expect of all our people. Did I mention cooperation? That too. As for Dow, Nesson, that is, he will be permitted to explain his role to you before we leave. The backup team will travel to Brefness separately. Having you together on the road might draw attention. Once you reach court, you keep out of each other's way. It will be necessary for your Uncle Art to exchange information with the temporary farrier, Eowyn, once or twice. And, of course, the second team will be ready if he calls them in. She pauses, as if considering what to say next. Your trainers mentioned that you have a habit of speaking your mind,
and I see they weren't wrong.
That isn't fair at all. What about Dow? If anyone has a habit of going right ahead and saying what's on his mind, it's him.
Maybe what I'm thinking shows on my face, though I hold the words back, for she adds, "That is a reasonable concern, Kira. You're known for being blunt, so is Nesson, but the role he's playing will make it easier for him to exercise the required discretion."
"Because he's shut away in the stables?" asks Brock.
"No," says Breed. "Because, for purposes of this mission, Nesson is mute. He won't speak a word to anyone."
Chapter 5. Dow. Day 67. I am on the mainland and preparing for a mission. An opportunity to be dreamed of. But why must they give me such a wretched role in it? I do not complain. Every word we utter, every move we make, must count toward our future chances. Besides, I can see the strategic value of a mute. A man who cannot speak cannot pass on what he hears. Furthermore, it will be assumed that a farrier's assistant cannot read or write. Folk will be careless about what they say in his presence. They may even assume that he is a little slow in his wits. Will it be bearable, in view of what hangs on this? I must indeed bear every moment of humiliation. I imagine Liobhan grinning, Brock concocting some humorous song about my plight. I think of them mocking me in whispers. Then I consider the possibility that some spoken message, something the speaker never suspects I will hear, let alone pass on, may provide the vital step towards solving the mystery, finding and restoring the mysterious harp, and returning to Swan Island covered in glory. Though in fact, we are more likely to slip back unobtrusively as ordinary folk going about their usual business. The disappearance and restoration of the Harp of Kings will be a tale known only to the regent and his close confidants. And to the five of us, of course, but we will keep our counsel. I am determined to say nothing of the unfairness of our roles, even to myself. I will not consider that Liobhan and her brother are already accomplished musicians, and that all they need do at the court of Brefner is be themselves and keep their ears open. I will not compare that with the job I have been given, impersonating a half-witted yokel. I will ignore the inequity of the situation and play my part perfectly. If there is any natural justice in this, I will acquit myself so well that Ahu cannot fail to give the island elders a good report of me later. I will swallow the desire to see Liobhan make errors. That might reduce her chances and bolster mine, but it could also lead to the failure of the enterprise, for which the regent has hired us. Besides, I am almost certain Livorne's thoughts run on the same path as mine. I have seen in her a fierce will to excel, almost equal to my own, but not quite. After all, she is a woman. And Brock? Brock will do what Brock does. Sing like an angel, touch the harp, and make folk weep. It could be that he will uncover clues more readily than either his sister or me. There is something about him that draws folk. Of the three of us, he is the one people are most likely to confide in. Perhaps Brock will excel on this mission. Most certainly, he cannot be discounted. We rehearse our stories endlessly. Our trainers surprise us with questions when we are eating, when we are preparing for bed, when we are concentrating on a task. I have heard both Liobhan and Brock make errors, responding to their real names. My enforced silence makes it easier. I may turn my head or make a movement when someone says Dow, but that need not mean I think it is my name. From our second day at the barn, I've been forbidden to speak, with a proviso that up until the day we leave, I may do so in an emergency. Also, on the last evening here, I will be permitted to talk at supper time. It follows that when I ride, I must control my mount without the use of my voice. It is just as well I am a horseman of some skill. And it means I cannot question Ullen, Own, from now until the mission is over, about the use of tools or anything at all about the work we are to do together. I will cope. I must. I will employ gestures, grunts, grimaces, whatever will serve best. This guise might have been invented for the sole purpose of making me look foolish. I wake in the dark of night, aware of something wrong, though there is no sound in the sleeping quarters but Brock's slow breathing. I sit up. A moment later, someone rams a cloth into my mouth and holds it there, hard. I gag and choke, fighting for breath. His other hand is tangled in my hair, pushing forward. I kick and twist with all my strength, and then a second man is there grabbing my legs, hauling me off the pallet. My heart is a wild drum. Cold sweat breaks out on my skin. They're quick and silent, dragging me towards the door. My shout comes off as a muffled groan. Brock stirs. Beyond the screen, Liobhan, half asleep, mutters, "Shut up!" and falls silent again. Almost through the doorway, my mind whirls. What is this, attack or test? Do I keep fighting or let this happen? We're along the hallway in the dark and into the chamber, and I hear the iron bolt go across the door. And in the uneven light of a single candle, I see two people in hooded cloaks, with cloths masking their features. That makes four of them. No hope of overpowering them all, even at my best. Curse Brock and Liobhan, and curse the long day that left them too weary to wake. The three of us together could have done it. The hand comes off my mouth, the cloth is removed, and I can breathe. An instant later, something goes over my head, a bag, a sack, and I can't see. The men holding me release their grip. Before I can do anything, someone seizes my wrists and binds them together behind my back. Right. It's a training exercise. A raid on the barn by outsiders wouldn't end here in this little chamber, with Brock and Liobhan unharmed in their beds, still within earshot. Not to speak of Ahu and the others. "Speak up," someone barks. "Who are you, and what are you doing here?" I work on my breathing. I straighten my back and hold my head high under the dark covering. "I said speak!" An open-handed blow on my cheek, through the cloth, sharp enough to sting. This is somewhat harsh, even by Swan Island standards. I grunt in response, as Nessun might. What comes next? What do they want from me? Tears? Screams that will bring Brock and Liobhan to my aid? If I give a wordless shout, and they come rushing in to save me, will that mean I pass the test and they fail? A matching blow for the other cheek. My neck hurts, and so do my wrists. The restraints are painfully tight. How am I supposed to do a farrier's job with my flesh rubbed raw? I make another noise louder than the first. With my wrists bound, I can't use gestures and explain that I'm dumb. It's a trick, Dao, I tell myself. Remember when your brothers locked you in the old chest? Or when they helped you climb to the top of the big elm tree, then left you there? Or the time they marooned you out in the middle of the marsh? Your wits saved you then. Use them now. But I don't need to, because someone starts hammering on the door and shouting, "What are you doing?" It's Liobhan. "Uncle Art, come quickly. Donal, where are you?" Morrigan's curse. She sounds terrified. That's surely no play acting. But it must be, because she used those names. I bow my head and start a wordless sobbing. If nothing else, the distraction might give her time for whatever it is she's planning. Someone pulls the bolt aside. Whoever was hitting me has stopped, for now at least. I gather myself and prepare to move, bound wrists and all. If I can get to my feet, I can smash my head into the man's face and break his nose. I can kick his legs from under him. I can... But no. Liobhan's voice comes again. She's surely right in the doorway. And I remember that I'm Nessun, and I'm so scared I won't get up and fight, not even for a woman in trouble. Instead, I do what a terrified, mute man might do at such a moment, which is to release a stream of urine down my own legs and onto the floor. "What are you doing?" Liobhan's voice is quavering, thready, barely recognizable. "Why has he got that thing over his head?"
None of your business, girl, says one of the men. Go back to bed. Forget you saw us. If you know what's good for you.
I won't go. You can't make me.
Her voice goes up a notch, as if she's so scared she's lost touch with common sense.
Why's that man tied up? Why are you here in the dark, in the middle of the night?
She must be planning something, or she'd retreat and let them get on with whatever they intend, perhaps to beat me to a pulp, before they tell me it's all some kind of act. Though that would be stupid if they really want me to ride to Brefne in a few days, and put on a convincing show when I get there. Someone makes an abrupt movement. There's the sound of a slap and a whimper from Liobhan.
You can't do that,
she says, and now her voice is like a hurt child's.
You can't hit me. I want Uncle Art. Kira, are you all right?
Through the bag over my head, I discern more light. That's Brock coming in, and he must have stopped to pick up a lantern on the way.
What is happening here? He asks. Cease.
This voice I know. It's Breed's. The covering is removed from my head, and I can see again. Liobhan's in the doorway, with a shawl thrown over her nightrobe. There's a red mark on her cheek where they struck her, and there's a knife in her hand, not quite concealed by the folds of her skirt. The light draws a telltale glint from it. That means she was prepared for both possibilities, test or real attack. Beside her is Brock, holding up the lantern, and although his manner is calm, his face is sheet white. I had wondered if the two of them were party to the whole thing, but it's plain this was a test for all three of us. Ahu and Ullen come in. The others, apart from Breed, are Swan Island men we did not know were on the mainland. They seat themselves at the table. I'm shaking. I can't seem to stop. I order myself to breathe slowly. Liobhan's expression is like a storm front waiting to break. She strides over with her knife in full view and cuts the bonds from my wrists. As she steps back, I see her nose wrinkle. Fair enough, since I stink of piss. There's plenty I could say to her, to Ahu, to Breed, to all of them. But dumb Nessan doesn't speak a word.
I won't offer an apology, says Breed, casting her eye over the three of us in turn.
Liobhan and Brock are still standing.
You all recognized quickly that this was an exercise, not an attack. That is what I would expect of you, even with your somewhat limited training. Kira, you look a little put out. Something to say?
Livorne's jaw tightens, and so do her fists. She shakes her head.
Let's hear your opinion of how the three of you performed just now, Ahu says. What did you do right? How could you have done better?
Liobhan sucks in a big breath and lets it out slowly.
I didn't see what happened to Nessan. I only woke up fully after he was gone from the sleeping quarters. I heard a disturbance. Sounds that told me it wasn't simply someone going to the privy or heading out for a stroll because they couldn't sleep. I didn't know at that stage whether it was a test or something else. It sounded as if Nessan was in trouble, perhaps being beaten, so I followed the voices and footsteps here. I thought before I came in that it must be a test, because who would create such a disturbance right inside the barn, with people sleeping so close by? For a moment, when you opened the door, I wasn't quite sure.
The ferocious look is back on her face, though she's trying to stay calm.
It looked uncomfortably real. I didn't like what you did, but that's not relevant. It was a test. I responded in character as Kira. I screamed for help. I called the others by their correct names.
But, Breed sounds stern, no trace of sympathy there.
Did you want me to act more like a girl?
Liobhan answers, iron with iron.
I could have woken Donal, told him I was scared, sent him instead of doing it myself. I could have stayed in bed with the covers over my head. But just because Kira's female and a musician, that needn't mean she has no backbone. I'll be more convincing in the role if I don't have to pretend I'm a wilting flower of a woman.
I could almost grin at that if I weren't feeling so uncomfortable between the wet trousers and the aching wrists.
Donal, says Ahu, what did she do wrong?
Brock clears his throat. He looks as if he'd much rather be somewhere else.
Speak up, says Breed. Set your personal feelings aside. Assess her performance as if you were her trainer.
She came armed. She didn't conceal the knife as well as she should have. And although she stayed in the part, she showed she lost her temper.
Kira is allowed this knife, Livorne snaps. Bringing it was only common sense. She's not a fighter. She's wandering around an unfamiliar building in the middle of the night. She knows something suspicious is going on. She'd be stupid not to take her weapon with her. And as for concealment, she wouldn't even be thinking of that.
Be calm, says Ahu. Self-control is vital in what we do. Now tell us, in measured words, what Donald did right and where he erred.
It would have been better if both of us had woken more quickly. I assume Nessun was forcibly taken from his bed, and I imagine he put up a fight. Donald stayed in character and came quickly enough once I called out, she grimaces. He stayed calm. All in all, a better performance than mine.
And Nessun?
Livorne's silent for a bit, staring across at me. Now I can't guess what she's thinking, but her hand goes up to touch the red mark on her face.
I didn't see everything you did to him, but I'd say he's done a faultless job of being a terrified stable hand.
A short silence.
He's hurt, his wrists and his face.
Not your concern, says Breed. And not so badly hurt that a little salve cannot mend him before he rides out.
Everything we do is calculated, Kira. Everything. We would not have the reputation we do if we went about these exercises carelessly.
If I could speak, I would tell Livorne I don't need a champion. I don't need her to get angry on my behalf. But then, if I were Dao and not weak Nessun, I might have called her and her brother to help me when I was attacked. Just as well I didn't. It would probably have got all of us sent home.
Kira?
Ahu is regarding Livorne closely. She doesn't drop her gaze.
All right. I lost my temper, and that showed lack of discipline. I'm not going to pretend I thought the exercise was fair and reasonable, because I didn't. You forbid someone to speak, then you drag him out of bed in the dark, tie him up and hurt him? In what way is that necessary? We can do this, the three of us. You must have faith in us, or we wouldn't have been chosen.
Breed makes a gesture to one of the men.
Fetch us some mead, will you?
She turns back towards Livorne.
Sit down. You too,
she adds to Brock.
When they have done so, she says, In the morning, on reflection, this will make better sense to all of you.
She looks me straight in the eye.
Well done, she says. That wasn't easy for you, but it's only a taste of what this is going to feel like from now until midsummer. It's a long time to stay silent. Thus far, your self-control seems good. Now go and change your clothing. Make sure that garment is washed and dried in time for your departure. When you're changed, come back here and I'll tend to your wrists. The injury is surely not so severe as Kira seems to think. It would be foolish to inflict serious damage on you just before we sent you out on a job. Still, an application of salve won't do any harm.
I take a candle and leave, glad of the chance to clean myself up. In our quarters, I strip off my wet trousers, drop them in a corner, and get into my other pair. Not sure if I'm angry with Breed and Ahu for concocting such a challenge, or pleased that I've apparently done well. Better than Livorne. Maybe I'm simply tired. We're all short of sleep.
Nessun.
I'm an instant away from snarling, what? But I see Livorne's expression and bite back the word. All I really want is to crawl into bed, pull the blanket over my head and forget the whole thing until morning. As well as everything else, my neck aches. But there she is by the screen, with a cloth and a little pot of something in her hands. In the candlelight, her hair is the colour of oak leaves in autumn sunshine, a glowing red gold.
Salve, she says. Bandage. I'll do it for you before we go back.
I shake my head, pull my shirt sleeves down over my wrist, can't help wincing. What's worse, Livorne says, letting me do it or having Breed do it and make the whole thing into another training exercise? A sit down. And don't look at me like that. I grew up in a healer's household. If you want your wrists in full working order before we go, this salve is your best hope. That's why I brought a supply with me, even with a limit on what we could carry. When I still don't move, mostly because I'm surprised she'd tell me anything at all about her past, she says again, "Sit down, please. I can do it quickly." She's not lying. It's plain that she's done this sort of thing hundreds of times before. Her hands are strong, that I knew already, but gentle when they need to be. I can't ask her what's in the stuff she's using, which is greenish-brown in colour, with a sharp woody smell, and she doesn't offer the information. When my wrists are salved, she uses her teeth to tear strips off the cloth and binds up my wounds, fastening the bandages with neat flat knots. "There, now those bruises on your face. It's all right, I won't mar your beauty. This stuff doesn't show once it's dry." She doesn't give me a chance to gesture "no thanks," but dabs some of the salve on my cheeks. When it's done, I point to Livorne's own face. The mark where someone slapped her stands out clearly on her fair skin. Livorne shrugs. "That? It's nothing. Not worth wasting this stuff on. Who knows when I'll have the opportunity to make more. Most of the components grow in deep forest, and that's a bit scarce in these parts. Now, if you're up to it, we'd best go back." I follow her out, wondering what she and her brother were like growing up. I do not know which is the elder. I had guessed it might be Brock, but I imagine Livorne took charge, gave him orders, assumed leadership, even though she was the girl. It makes me wonder again about their parents. It's plain they are not of high status. One parent is a healer, most likely the mother. Yet here are brother and sister, with expertise as both musicians and fighters. Why wouldn't Livorne take up her mother's craft, since it seems she may have a flair for that as well? Perhaps the father is a household guard to some noble family. That could explain the combat skills. I look at the mark on her face and think, what man in his right mind would allow his daughter to become a fighter?
Chapter 6. Brock. I don't like seeing my sister hurt. I don't like standing by and letting it happen because I've been ordered to stay in the character I'm bound to. That man has no sister, only a fellow musician. I must have done well enough, uncomfortable as I was with the midnight exercise. When it was over, they praised me for my self-restraint. In truth, I was much disturbed by what occurred. The rest of that night, I didn't sleep at all, but went over and over the events, asking myself what if the mock attack they carried out had been a real one, and I hadn't realized until it was too late. Livorne could have been killed, others too, a bloodbath, while I stood by and let it happen. We've been practicing keen observation, discretion, and silence. We're learning to move like shadows and to listen like wild creatures. But our trainers haven't forgotten our need to exercise more familiar skills. Each day we're given time to rehearse and to add new material to the songs and dances we already know. At our trainer's request, we provided entertainment after supper tonight. The audience was small but appreciative. The two men from the second team, our trainers, and some other Swan Island folk, who I assume are here doing their preparation for a completely different mission. We know better than to ask about such things. There were guards, too. Warriors from the island are sent here in turn to undertake the job of keeping the settlement and all who work here safe. I wonder which one of them struck Livorne in the face, or whether he noticed that she still wears the mark of that blow. I wondered if they knew a knock like that would make both singing and whistle-playing uncomfortable, if not impossible. I said nothing. Livorne fights her own battles, and she wouldn't think this one worth the trouble. At supper, Dow was given leave to join in the conversation. On the island, he always had plenty to say for himself. He is a man full of opinions. Tonight, given permission to speak, he barely did so. He ate and watched as we performed and answered questions with a word or two. I had thought he, of all people, would approach this mission with complete confidence. His belief in his own abilities has seemed unshakable. But the look on his face suggested his gut was churning with unease, just like mine. I miss our parents. I miss home. I miss the fresh, clean smell of Mother's still room. I wish I could talk to Father, or walk with him in silence through the woods, or lend him a hand with digging a well, or laying a dry stone wall, or dealing with someone's troublesome livestock. I wish I could be at Winter Falls, playing music for friends. I don't want to share my songs in some distant court full of strangers. I wish I didn't have to go so far away. I miss my brother. I wish he was here to tell me I'm foolish and to reassure me that, in the end, all of us will come safely home.
Chapter 7. Liobhan. The sooner we get to Brefna, the better chance we have of finding this harp in time. But travelling too quickly would draw attention. Most nights we'll find a wayside inn or the home of a landholder and offer entertainment in return for food, lodgings and safe stabling for the horses. If our audience wants to throw a few coppers our way, so much the better. Once we reach our destination, Lord Kara will ensure we're hired for the period leading to the ritual, when the royal household will fill up with visitors. We can't ride the same horses all the way. When I ask Ahu about this, he says there are trusted folk at various locations who can provide us with fresh mounts, no questions asked. He doesn't explain who these people are, but I guess they're linked to Swan Island in some way. It makes me wonder how far the island community's influence stretches and how they manage to keep their operations covert. The arrangement with the horses will allow us to reach Brefna with just over one turning of the moon to complete our mission. It's not long. There are no lingering goodbyes. Reed gives Brock and me some final instructions. Ahu checks our bags. We get our horses saddled and load our gear. And it's time to go. It's still early. Ullen and Dow left when it was barely dawn. A cool mist lies over the fields as we ride away from the settlement. Brock is tight-lipped. Ahu has insisted the harp be loaded onto the pack horse, and my brother is less than pleased. That instrument is almost like a child to him, and he assumed he would ride with it strapped to his back. But Ahu is the mission leader, and his word is law.
"Pull your skirt down, Kira,"
growls Ahu as we near a settlement later in the morning. "It looks unseemly." It looks all right to me, even with the hem tucked into my belt, since I'm wearing my trousers underneath. But I tug it back down to the extent possible while riding astride. "Sorry, Uncle." I attempt a contrite tone, and Brock, who's riding just behind me, lets out a snort. "It's not funny, Donal."
"I could make up a song about that," Brock says. "There'd be a girl dancing. At the urging of her audience, she lifts her skirt to show her ankle, and then to show her calf, and then higher still. It'd go down quite well in the drinking halls, don't you think?"
Evidently, the morning's ride has improved his mood. "The men would like it, no doubt," I say. I can imagine the scene all too clearly. The rowdy audience in the drinking hall would urge me to illustrate the song with gestures. "Why doesn't the girl in your song turn the tables on whoever's watching? Maybe she's got a deadly weapon concealed under the skirt and uses it to rob them of their remaining funds. Or maybe once the skirt reaches a certain level, it's revealed that she isn't a woman at all, but something else."
"A man?" suggests Ahu.
"I was thinking she might be an uncanny creature of some kind. Something with tentacles, perhaps, or lots of hairy legs." "The enticing maiden might be an ancient crone in disguise." A certain note in Brock's voice tells me he's already thinking up verses. "Her vile appearance would stop them from asking to see a girl's legs again, for a while at least." "I prefer the tentacles myself," I say. "That maiden, who is secretly a crone, is in too many tales already. But it's up to you. You can sing this one, and I'll play a whistle part. That way nobody can expect me to do actions." Brock mutters verses and hums snatches of melody every day as we ride. He's always inventing something new. When he's satisfied with the skirt song, he makes me memorise the words as well as the tune. "Just in case," he says. Just in case what? I told you I didn't want to sing this one.
What if I get a sore throat? You might need to do all the singing.
Then we'd perform something different.
This one's going to be popular. Just wait and see. They'll be thumping their fists on the tables. Word will go ahead of us and we'll be flooded with requests.
That's what I'm worried about, I say. A bunch of men behaving like roosters in the barn. Back home, when we perform for a crowd, folk don't shout lewd remarks or give me suggestive looks. Not often, anyway. And when it happens, it isn't the locals who do it. Anyone who knows me, in person or by reputation, knows I'm not to be meddled with. Not only can I give as good as I get, but I have my own real-life version of Uncle Art in the person of my father, Master Grimm, a giant of a man in more ways than the obvious. But Father isn't here, and he isn't close by to make sure anyone who speaks ill to me is taught his lesson. It makes being on the road as Kira, who dresses in gowns even when riding and wears her hair flowing over her shoulders, feel even more uncomfortable.
"Forgotten me, have you?" puts in Ahu. "I can sing if I have to. As for the roosters, I've silenced a few in my time. Just remember to draw breath before you act. If there's a brawl, better me in the middle of it than you."
I'm about to promise I'll stay out of trouble, but I stop myself. Promises have a habit of coming back to bite you.
Chapter 8. Dow. Day 12 of the ride from Swan Island to the court of Brefne. Ullen leads the way along a winding side track, with the day fading to the long summer twilight. The horses are weary. At the end of this road lies a household of friends. We'll leave these horses at their holding, where fresh mounts are ready for us. I have wondered how messages travel from the island to these friends so many days' ride away. Perhaps they keep messenger pigeons in Swan Island's mainland settlement. If so, the birds are well concealed. Ullen has not yet given me permission to use my voice here. I'm to maintain my silence throughout our journey, except for our whispered conversations when we can be sure we are alone. I do my best to accept this. Discipline is part of the warrior's journey, and I must demonstrate that I can exercise it perfectly. A dog announces our arrival, a big, dark-coloured hound hurling itself toward us, baying. We are quick to rein in our startled horses. I dismount in silence, laying a reassuring hand on my horse's neck. The dog has halted no more than one long stride away from me, hackles up, still in full voice. It may look as if it wants to eat me, but it's a farm dog, and only doing its job. I don't meet its gaze direct. Instead, I look a little to the side. I make my pose as easy as I can. She
quiets. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.